Thank you, Professor Pathak and Kartika, for introducing me, for a kind introduction. I'm very happy to be here and I'm grateful to Dr. Ranjit Singh for inviting me here. My namaste and good morning to all of the chairperson, eminent, very good personalities. I've met some of them and some of them I haven't met. So for the first time, I'm meeting many of you. And the forensic area, the area of research, what many of you, as well as many of the Indian scientists are doing, is getting exciting with the technological development. And I would like to congratulate to all the Indian aspirants here, because today is the National Science Day. So today is celebrated as the National Science Day in India. So the technological advancement has helped to understand the differentiation and the discrimination that we could make for two different personalities living in the world. And this is the basic fundamental aspect of the forensic genetics, where we use various technologies to identify a known sample, to differentiate two similar personalities who have very common similarities, very common phenotype, but still they differ genetically. So these genetics and these variations is the basic fundamental aspect which we need to differentiate people. So I have few of the slides which I would like to show you, and then we could discuss further how this technological advancement has helped us to understand and to more differentiate the populations living in this world. I'm trying to put a slide. Hope this is visible for you. My slides are visible.
Sir, it's coming. That is showing that you have shared your screen, but still we are not able to see the PPT content. Sometimes it takes 10 to 15 seconds for streaming. Sir, I think due to some network issue, it is not showing. Can you reshare again, sir?
Okay. I'm just stopping.
Please reshare again, sir. Yes, sir, it's coming perfectly fine, sir.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
Okay, so today's talk will be all about the new exciting technologies, which is coming up, and slowly, people working in this area, they are trying to find out the best way to differentiate two people. So let us have some background about these technologies, which is being used since more than 200 years, actually, to differentiate the people. So it was 1888 when there was a very exciting paper in the Nature, which has showed that the fingerprints could be the best tool to differentiate two different personalities. And it could be used as a marker for a particular individual. So that time, nobody knows that always, whether it is a DNA fingerprinting or whatever, the fingerprinting could be a tagline. So wherever we use this terminology, the fingerprinting comes from the time when, like more than 100 years ago, people would have actually differentiated this term and then coined this term. So in forensic analysis, what are the basic things? For example, like if the whole world population is more than 7 billion people, and what is the best technology which could differentiate two individuals coming from any region or any population? That is the our prime focus, which can be used in forensic analysis. So people usually look the best technology which can differentiate two people. So, and if we obtain a DNA from an unknown individual, so what by the analysis of this DNA, what we can determine, what we can find out by analysis of this DNA, whether we can reconstruct the whole personality of this person, we can find out that whether this person has which eye color, what was the hair color of this person, how was the texture. So there are several exciting work, exciting discoveries going on with the technological advancement. And one most important thing is, if we don't have any forensic identification database, then we could not move in this area, because a huge number of database is required. When we analyze an unknown sample, then we need a huge, big forensic database. And with this database, we could identify whether this person is related with some community, related with some region, or whatever. So this is the main question people are trying to find out. And with this advancement, there are autosomal and then the sex chromosomal markers. So the haploid and diploid markers, both of the markers are being used for various specific purposes. And here, the paternal marker, that is Y chromosome, and the maternal marker, which comes from the mother, that is mitochondrial DNA, are very useful to some of the specific cases where people have to identify whether this person has some maternal ancestry or some paternal ancestry connected with some unknown personality. And except for some of the cases where there is the amelogenine deletion, most of the amelogenine tests, they are very perfect and very good to identify and to sex the people into male and female sexes. So this reliability of this population specific and this regional specific are also gaining importance nowadays, because the predicting a population origin based on unknown sample is another aspect which we would discuss further. And then there are ancestry informative markers, because now we have the huge information coming from our 3.2 billion longer genome. So these base pairs are helping us identify each and every continental population. Scientists have already done to identify some of the markers which are very specific into various continents. So these are coming up, and slowly we are building up and trying to find out. Even in India, we see that there are several states. So there are some markers which could differentiate people living in two different states. So, and with India, what is very good for the forensic is, like, we have endogamous groups. So these endogamous groups, and they intermarry within a group. So these group marriages usually create a unique genetic profile, and this profile helps us to understand and to identify the people living in this particular society. And for example, if you take the iris plates that use to differentiate the eye color based on six pigmentation gene present on our several chromosomes. So at the moment, we could identify at least 93% to 91% differentiate people with the blue and brown eye color. So slowly the things are building up, and we could able to make much more robust analysis and much more robust information about the people and to help the forensic technologies. So if you go back few generations, like 20 to 25 years, then we see that there are single nucleotides the SNPs, and then there are the variation which is called as tandem sequences. So these tandem sequences, they are the repeat sequences, and the mutation in these repeats are like, sometimes you see that the differences are less and sometimes the differences are more. So it always like expands and then reduces. So the mutation is not like it always increases the number of repeats, but the mutation also decreases the number of repeats. And this is why this number of repeats are being used in a standard purpose for differentiating people in the forensic analysis. And 15, 10 years back, when usually we do the gel analysis, we run the gels with the various length of the markers, we compare individuals, and based on here, for example, we have given the three individuals, and these individuals have been differentiated based on the gel pattern, which we draw from various combinations of markers. These are the battery of markers. These markers, they usually run on the gel, and these gel is being scanned with the laser scanner. This was like 15 years, 20 years back, and there was the availability of gel pattern was very prominent, and that was very much used. And here you see that these are three independent individuals, and you could see that the gel pattern and the bands which are being displayed here is very drastically different from one another, and they are also very individual specific. So, and if you see the pattern of a family, where there is a mother, father, and the son, you can clearly see that almost half of the alleles are usually coming from, of the son, usually comes from the mother, and half of the alleles comes from the father. So these I'm talking all about the autosomal DNA. At the moment, we're not talking about the mitochondrial DNA and Y chromosomal DNA. We could see further that how mitochondrial DNA and Y chromosomal DNA are helping us to differentiate some of the cases. So here you see that one of the band of the son usually matches with the father, and the other band usually matches with the mother. So here one can clearly see that these alleles and these the battery of the markers are usually help us to easily identify and easily establish the biological ancestry. So then further, few more markers have come into the limelight and people started using, and as you know that the PCR was one of the major input in this area that has helped us to differentiate and to amplify the small amount and the small region of the DNA. So what was the major problem? Because the problem in the forensics is like, we do not usually get a huge amount of DNA, which is usually available. If you do the population-based analysis, you can get even one to five nanograms of DNA, micrograms of DNA. But here, the nanograms of DNA is very less, the amount of the DNA is very less. So when the amount of the DNA is very less, even the technology is available to sequence the complete genome, but there, sequencing a complete genome needs at least 2 to 3 microgram of the DNA, and that is impossible if you have some kind of forensic assault cases. So people are trying to find out the methodologies, the identification system, where we could clearly amplify more and more region of the person from their genome so that one can differentiate people. And this is the picture of one of the profile where you see that in some of the markers, you could see just one band, whereas in some of the markers, you could see two bands. So this is like homozygous and heterozygous. When a person receives the same allele from father and mother, so the same allele usually comes, the same allele comes in the picture, whereas when they differentiate two different alleles, then you could see the two different bands, and there is a endogenine marker which identify the sex of that known or unknown individual. So the current DNA profiling, which is now being used, is actually a mix of 23, 15, 17, even even hundreds of the markers. So these markers are, if we look the autosomes, these markers are being inherited 50% from mother, 50% from the father. And here, if you compare the banding pattern of the son with the father and mother, you can see that almost half of the bands and almost half of the peaks are coming from the mother and half of the peaks are coming from the father. And there could be some of the mutations which one may also see among the son. So this is like just a one repeat difference, and this one repeat difference is because of the mutation which has happened in the son. So this kind of DNA profiling usually we get from the people. And there was another discussion and another question people keep on discussing, that is there any option where we could do the biogeographic ancestry? Biogeographic ancestry means if we have unknown sample, we don't know about origin about this unknown sample. So whether how accurately you could establish the identity of this unknown sample. So there was a DNA brain forensics which has used this information, and they have used DNA witness software where they have used the ancestry informative markers, and based on ancestry informative, they have used 176 ancestry informative markers. And these ancestry informative markers could differentiate the various continental populations. And these various continental populations, one could identify that the suspect is coming from which region. But this is just at a broader scale. You need to still find out at a micro scale to differentiate people based on the biogeographic ancestry. I'd like to bring one of the question which we tried to solve in the 2013-14, where there was a sample which was suspected to be Georgian queen, Ketevan, there was just a femur bone was available for this from the Goa, and we isolated DNA. The mitochondrial DNA was much easier to isolate from this sample. We isolated the DNA and we tried to identify whether this unknown femur sample is coming from some Indian population or from some other continental and subcontinental population. So what we had done, we had used their mitochondrial DNA, the hypervariable segment 1, and some of the coding region mutations. These region mutations have been amplified and sequenced. And with these sequences, we have used, again, as I said earlier, that we need a large number of databases to compare to the population. And here we were quite fortunate that because the queen was from Georgia, and Georgian mitochondrial DNA and Indian mitochondrial DNA are drastically different. There are few groups which are shared between both of the population, but here we could identify one of the branches, that is U1B, which is not present at all in India, and that branch was showing into the suspected sample, and based on that we could establish that there is a high likely chances that the sample is coming from in Georgia. So in this case, we are very fortunate. But if we take an example, like if there is some unknown sample within India, if we need to compare with the Indian population, so this technology or this method would not at all help. So we need to go more further. We need to identify the regional, not only for mitochondria, mitochondrial DNA, because mitochondrial DNA is very much diverse of Indian population, and there is no like very regional pattern except for northeastern part of India and some other regions. So we need to use the autosomal DNA and some other markers which could help us. And again, we have to remember that the amount of the DNA is usually much, much lower. So we need to keep some technologies which use less amount of DNA, but they could produce more amount of the results. So we also designed by using the mitochondrial DNA and Y chromosomal markers, we designed the Indian M-plex, where we could differentiate the different M haplogroup of India, Asian plex, which could differentiate different Asian haplogroup based on their country profile, and there is more advanced technique, that is Luminar asymmetrics, the array data, where we have more than 500,000 of SNPs. But this again needs, at the moment, at least 500 nanogram of DNA, which is at the moment is impossible. But still, we are trying to find out few methods where very less amount of DNA is usually being used and to use for the forensic information. And then there are Indian Y-plex, we have designed. So this Y-plex uses various Indian markers, Y chromosomal heterobrook marker, and based on that, we can differentiate that this particular sample, unknown sample, is coming from which region of mitochondrial DNA. So by using the autosomal the data, autosomal speed data, if we design the whole skeleton of the population of the African and Eurasian population, so we can clearly see that most of the Indian population, they share just a single branch, and all of them show a very good DNA profile and DNA connection with each other. In the Indian Austroasiatic, Indian Dravidian, these are the various language groups presenting to India. So we can clearly see that these groups, they all of them, they share their genetic profile and they are connected with a common thread. So if we place some unknown sample, we could clearly differentiate that whether this unknown sample is falling in which group of the region. But still, we need to increase the resolution of this particular case. So there are principal component analysis where one can see the geographical differentiation of the population. When we put the population, you can see that the northern Indian population, the southern Indian population, the central Indian population, they make a clear cut pattern. And if we blindly put an unknown sample into this map, we could clearly differentiate that whether this sample is coming from northern India or central India or eastern part of India or southern part of India. But if we still need to make a differentiation within southern part or within the northern part, we still have to increase our resolution with the lower amount of the DNA. And this is the admixture plot, which is being used in the population genetics. And here you see that each and every population has a very unique color palette. So these one color palette actually shows ancestry. So these ancestry patterns are usually being used to identify for an unknown individual into the group of population. For that, again, we need the large DNA database here. For example, if you see that how the various population groups living in India, they have the ancestry pattern. You see that Pakistani groups are different, North Indians, they are showing their unique pattern. Then they are going Nihali, the North and Southern Munda, and the South Indians, they have again another kind of ancestry pattern. So if we just throw the unknown sample and look their ancestry pattern, we could easily identify their origin of geography, their geographic origin. So there was another question, which was still going on, and we are trying to identify these people. So there was a massacre in 1857 when the Indian rebellion had been killed by the colonial people, and then they had put them into a well in the Punjab. And our collaborators, Dr. Neeraj Rai, and our collaborators from Punjab group, they have isolated the DNA from this group of individuals. And when we place their mitochondrial DNA into the big picture coming from the whole region of India, you could see that this group of individual is usually coming from the Bihar, Eastern Uttar Pradesh, Jharkhand, East Bengal region. So here is the use of forensic information and the huge database information that can be incorporated into the identifying of the unknown sample. These unknown samples can be differentiated at least now at the moment at the state level. So within 500 kilometers, we could differentiate the individuals coming from two different regions. But still, if individuals are coming from, let's say, 50 kilometers, coming from 100 kilometers, it is still harder with the limited amount of DNA information to differentiate them. So by using the technological advancement, we are trying to develop new markers, new methods, and by sequencing the reference individuals, the reference sequences from various regions to find out ancestry informative markers from each and every group. Like for example, if a group is having some mutations which are very unique and present into only into their groups, you could just extract this mutation, make a new chip, and this chip can be genotyped into the unknown population, unknown sample, and this sample could be easily identified that this sample is belonging to this group. So by using this new technologies, new information, and these information are still for the identical twins, you need to sequence them completely, and the identical twins are sequenced completely, then you could clearly see the differences, but still we are trying to see if there is a particular region of the of 1 to 22 chromosomes, which could differentiate all the identical twins present in the world. This is still a question which we are trying to differentiate. And the commercially available, the PCR kits, they are giving a very low probability that a profile is having, is the common profile identified in one population is usually not copied completely and from completely from another population. So this PCR multiplexes, they are easily available and they are easily can differentiate two people, but still we need to differentiate the individuals on more, in a much more robust practice. So the forensic identification databases are must. We need to create, and some of the countries have already created very huge amount of the forensic database, but for India, we need to still develop a huge database which could be used for the forensic purposes. And the biogeographical origin is actually a developing field that is usually helping to identify the unknown samples coming from various continental and subcontinental populations. The Y chromosome and mitochondrial DNA are also being used, and they have been developed into such a manner that they can be specialized for forensic analysis. And sex determination is very well established. So for the DNA samples, there is no need for a much more accuracy, but the eye color prediction and hair color phenotypes, they are developing, and the new SNPs, they are coming up slowly, and we could usually design a very nice multiplex or very nice genotype chip to differentiate these people. So, and the technological revolution which is being used in the era of personal genomics, where a person use the companies, generate their own DNA, and then put into the common platform, which can be used for the researcher for their individual ancestry purposes, that is also worthwhile to help. So I would like to thank Dr. Pankaj sir and his team. They are the one who has helped us to collect the samples, to identify the samples, and to discuss some of the questions which are usually coming in their routine analysis. And thanks to the person who has brought me into the science. Thank you very much.